Hi, good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship at Garner Free Church. Welcome in the back, in the balcony, nosebleeds, in the bright shining sun, and in the shade, and online. We should be going live as well. So good to see you all. If you want to, in your vehicles, if you can't hear me very well, can you hear me okay? Do I have a thumbs up? You can't hear? Need it higher? We need a little bit more volume from the mains. If you're tuning in on the radio, we are on 88.1 FM this week. So we're moving up in the world. We got out of the AM band and we're in FM. 88.1 that was. So details about this morning's service. This door right here on the west side is available for urgent restroom use. Please don't go anywhere else in the building. We don't have plans to clean all of that right now. Rob is going to be giving the message this morning, and we will do our worship time in music afterwards. There is a box for offering that hopefully is not going to have checks blow away this week. It's up here by the corner of the building. There is hand sanitizer there too as well. And again, that's 88.1 FM if you're tuning in your vehicle. Next week, the plan is to move indoors. We're going to be doing a very hybrid approach to how we're doing worship. We'll have an area on the grass here, just like this week. We'll have area inside. Everything else in the vehicles will be completely available, and we will be streaming live for online. So this is kind of a bit of a prelude to that approach. So if you have any questions about how any of that is working, you can refer to Pastor Haddon's emails from last week. And for those who are planning on worshiping inside, I believe we're asking that you contact Elizabeth just to let her know so we can appropriately plan for chairs and whatnot. But if you'd forget or change your mind at the last minute, please feel free to come inside and we'll get everything figured out. We do need some volunteers for that effort, both for ushering and for cleaning. So if you'd be available and willing to help out with any of that, please contact Elizabeth. Pastor Haddon is out of town this week. I believe he's coming back after next week. But in the meantime, if you need any pastoral needs, you can contact myself or Pat Ennis or Will Kessler. The Kids Life Adventure Camp at Home, there is still time to request the free Adventure Camp at Home curriculum. There is home delivery to that available anywhere in North Iowa in mid-July. Awana this fall, we are in need of a new Awana commander. So if helping serve the children is something you'd like to help with, or if you have questions as to what it might look like, please email Elizabeth. Our missionaries of the month are Manuel and Hannah Garcia. They're asking for prayers for the kids and their families and their ministries during this time. Iquitos is hit pretty hard with people not being able to work due to the virus. I think that's about it. I'm unprepared for the scripture here, so bear with me. We are in Psalm 34. Psalm 34, verses 1 through 10. And hadn't read some of this last week as well. This is part of our Fighter Verse initiative. So verses 1 through 10. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. The Lord makes its boast. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. That was Psalm 34, 1 through 10. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for the beautiful weather, the breeze that's coming through, and the sun that's shining down. We pray that your Spirit would be here this morning and touch each one of us where it is that you'd have us learn this morning. Lord, we invite your Spirit into this service, and we thank you that we can come to you. Lord, we thank you that we can lay our needs at your feet and to know that you are a good God and that you will provide. Lord, we thank you for your sovereignty in this time. We thank you that no matter what is happening in this world, whether it's this virus or it's personal health concerns or personal loss, Lord, we thank you that you are willing to be with us. The creator of this universe is willing to be with us. Lord, we thank you for that, and we praise your name. Lord, please help every one of us seek your name and be humble in the way that we live our lives. Lord, we pray that pride would not be any part of what we do, and that you would be the one who we would always point to. Lord, we pray for the Garcias. We thank you for their ministry in Iquitos. We pray that those who are affected either directly by the virus from a health perspective there would be healed and that it wouldn't reach any further. And those who are affected economically, Lord, who are unable to work because of this, we pray that you would lend your comforting hand to them and that you would be the light in Iquitos. Lord, please be with Rob this morning. Protect him and give him the words that you'd have him speak and reach each one of us where we're at. And again, Lord, we just thank you and we pray that you would be with us during this time of worship. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So, Rob, you guys don't have to listen to me anymore, so that's good.
After this, they probably want to listen to you back. Good morning. Man, it's been about a year since I was actually able to stand in front of you guys and actually be able to teach. And I, just like then, I consider it a joy and an honor to be able to stand before you guys and to teach out of the Word, something I don't take lightly, as you guys know. And it's interesting, the fighter verse says this, "Oh, fear the Lord," in verse 9, "you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack." We're going to drive at that point this morning. Father, we just come before your word, Lord. We the word that you have given to me to share today is a strong burden on my heart. I know that you have asked me to walk in these steps and to follow it. And Father, I just pray that your Spirit, your word would come through in love, in power, that we would walk in you in reverence and in fear, that we would hold to you as supreme, as our author, as our creator, as our one and only true God, Lord. We approach your word right now, Lord, and we ask that you would just come and open our hearts, soften our hearts, see if there is any hardened areas in our lives that we need to repent of, that we come before you wanting to be a pure, spotless, holy bride. Father, we just stand before you now and before your word. Amen. So in China, leading up to the day of a wedding, the groom first goes back to his parents' house, and he actually prepares a room in his parents' house. He actually goes and he redecorates, he rebuilds it, he completely redoes it, redoes the windows, redoes the paint, redoes all the trimmings, and usually purchases a brand new bed and all of that. A bedroom, a honeymoon suite, if you will, for him and his bride. And on the day of their wedding, when the preparations are complete, he goes to his betrothed, his future wife's house, and he actually begs in front of her parents and pays a bride price. One that's obviously set before him, but he pays the bride price. And then once that is settled, he's actually able to walk into her bedroom and remove her, carry her out of the bedroom through the threshold, and transports her to her father's house. And there's a big parade. There's fireworks going off. There's a big to-do in all of this as he celebrates his wedding day. There's even a wedding feast that is prepared on that day. Once he brings her to the father's house, his father's house, they celebrate a feast, usually a lunch, which carries into a dinner, which carries into usually around midnight, 1 o'clock, when the guests finally walk out the door. And then he actually consummates the marriage. And they cleave to one another. They become one flesh. Can we already see the similarities of this Asian tradition in China with the similarities of the Asian tradition out of God's Word? Does this remind you of anything of the promises and the glorious day when Christ comes to find us? Our text this morning is actually going to come out of Ephesians chapter 5. Chapter 5, beginning in verse 21. It reads, "Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of word with by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. And in the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband." So this passage is often taught from a husband and wife relationship. This one's often taught at marriage conferences and so on. But the interesting thing here is Paul tells us that this isn't just about husbands and wives. This is about the body and the church. And it's from this standpoint today, from this perspective, that we are actually going to be reviewing this text. He calls it a profound mystery, and a profound indeed. I see the whole section broken up into two aspects. The first section is the idea of submitting or respect, fear, respectful fear toward Christ. And the second part is love. And so as we get into the first four verses here, this will make it easier. Sorry about that. So as we get into these first four verses, we notice that this is speaking directly to the heart of man, right? Directly to the heart of husbands. Because it's all about authority. It's all about respect. It's something that we naturally do in the military. It presents a hierarchy, a headship, an authority. The interesting part here is it also tells us that this idea of submitting is something that we learn from our wives. We learn from the women in how to do godly submission. Notice also, though, the other thing is that this is not natural for women to do. Okay? Submitting to her husband, coming underneath her husband, is not natural. It's part of the curse. This is why in Genesis 3, chapter 3, verse 6, it says, "The woman shall have a desire for her husband, and she shall, but he will rule over her." This desire for her husband isn't a passion. What it means is she wants to take the role or the lead over her husband. But it is interesting, though, that if we take this comparison of the fall and the woman having a desire to be over her husband, but then we also compare that to Proverbs chapter 31 of the biblical idea of a godly woman and how that submission looks, we can make an honest comparison of how God desires for us to submit to him in all things. And man, what a beautiful thing it is when a woman is submitting according to the biblical text as God has demanded. So as we go through this, we're also going to notice that this is also what's commanded of us, of the church. And so there will be a couple things from these passages. One is that Christ is concerned first and foremost about reverence for him and of our reverence to him. And I say this because the text itself bookends. It's called an inclusio. The beginning of the text and the end of the text actually has the same aspect here. Notice in verse 21, it says, "Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ is something that we're commanded to do." And verse 33, "Let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband." It's all about the reverence, the fear, this awe-inspiring passion towards Christ. And this is what drives us to act and move. The word here to submit, notice how many times it comes up. It talks about submitting in verse 21. Submit in verse 22. Submits in verse 24. And so on in this section. This whole word, this whole phrase of submitting hopefully is not sitting well with anybody, because it's not normal, it's not natural for us. According to Strong's Concordance, this is what it means. It means to come under in obedience, to subdue, to put ourselves under, to become subjection to. It implies an idea of a slave that submits to their master. And in fact, this is the language that is actually being portrayed here, is that we as slaves are submitting to our Lord or our master, which is also the same term. Notice at the end of verse 22, it says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord." That word Lord there is all can also be translated as master. But just as this is not talking about husband and wives, it's also talking about the church. Okay, wives or church, submit to Christ, because he is our master. And it's not just here in the word submit that we see this. It's not just here in the word reverence or to respect, which actually is a root word for phobia, is where we get our word phobia or fear. And it goes beyond just a simple fear of the mouse that we saw earlier. It goes to the fear or honest respect that we have of somebody else being above us and over us. And so as we read through this, Christ is telling us to, for one, submit to each other. Wives, or the church, submit to him as the master. The husband, or Christ, is the head over the church. Okay, he has the authority. He has the reason, or the command over our lives to do exactly as he dictates to us to do. And we as slaves are simply to obey his word. And notice in verse 24, it's not just obey his word, but it's to obey to the uttermost in everything. But why do we ask? Okay, why is this something that I'm bringing up? Why do we need to learn submission in this church? Okay, verse 23 goes on to further explain this. For the simple reason that Christ is our Savior, and no other reason. But what does that really mean? It means he died for us. It means he was willing to love us so much that he was actually took on the punishment that was designed for slaves. But the master himself actually died in our place. That is an aspect of being the Savior of us. He took the whippings. He took the wrongs that we were supposed to have. Listen to Philippians 2, 5 through 8. Very familiar verse, right? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it mockery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a slave and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in the appearance as a man or a slave, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death. God's perspective of mankind is that we are to be slaves to him. 1 Corinthians 6, and do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which is in you, whom you have from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. So glorify God with your body. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 to 20. And then also in 1 Corinthians 7, 22 to 23, for he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, he who is called as free is Christ's slave. You were bought at a price, so do not become slaves of men, but rather we should become slaves of God. And so if we are to have this same mind, like Philippians tells us, if we are to have the mind of Christ, then we are to humble ourselves as slaves and be obedient even to the point of death. Just as Christ did, he willingly went to the cross. He willingly faced death. Consider these words of Christ himself. Okay, we hear them a lot, but are we really taking them in? Matthew 16. Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 to 26. Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, beginning in verse 25. Now great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and his mother, or his wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost? And he continues on with this idea of counting the cost of following him going to death. In verse 33, he repeats, so therefore any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. I don't think he's just talking about verbal renouncing. So for us here as a church, in this time of a virus, in this time of uncertainty that we are all facing, and not just us here, but all around the world, what does that practically look like for us? Verse 24 in Ephesians 5 tells us that we are to submit to our master, submitting in everything. This means our goals, our futures, our health, our business, our families, our kids. Okay? It means submitting our entire lives. And if we are to submit the way Christ has submitted, it means to giving them up to death, submitting all of that we have to destruction, and all for the sake of following him and being obedient to him. In 1 Corinthians 5, verse 30, or sorry, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 30. Paul's perspective says this: why are we in danger every hour? I protest, brothers, by my pride in you, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die every day. What do I gain if, humanly speaking, I fought with the beast at Ephesus? If the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. But do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. Wake up from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning, for some have no knowledge of God, and I say this to your shame. Let us consider as a church right now that do we have the same perspective that Paul has? What is he saying here? He's walking every day, even to the point that he might be in chains, to the point that he might be flogged again with that last lash that takes his life. He might be stoned to death. He might fight with the beasts in the arena in Ephesus, but he considers that pride in sharing the gospel to those in Corinth there. He is willing to sacrifice all that he has and all that he is for the sake of others. Do we have this perspective? Can we say right now, during this virus, that we share this same mentality that Christ himself has asked us to have if we submit to him? And notice that Paul can do this because he's talking about our hope that we are guaranteed to be risen again from the grave, that our hope is that our groom will come and whisk us away to the place that he has prepared for us. This is the hope that we can stand in and stand firm in, and what we have believed. If we truly are to mimic Christ, if we are to be slaves who count the cost of following him, if we are to follow Christ even to death's door, then why do I see the church so afraid to die? Why do we have people that are so afraid to die? I asked my friend in China about this virus thing, and if he's experiencing the same thing there, what is it like for the church in China right now going through the exact same thing we are? This is what he responded. He echoed, actually, what we are experiencing here is exactly what the church is doing there. Is that the church itself is afraid to die. They're afraid to meet. They're afraid to come together. We value our own lives above all else. And unfortunately, this isn't just here in Garner or in America. This, to our shame as the body of Christ, is happening all around the world. Do we really believe that God is able to raise the dead? Do we really believe that he is the God of the living? Can we proclaim that he's the God of the living and not the dead? Do we understand what this means when we proclaim it? It's not talking about preserving this life right here. When God is the God of the dead, or the God of the living and not the dead, he's talking about our resurrection, our hope of our glorious time of being reunited with him at the marriage supper of the Lamb, that we will have new bodies, that we will be glorified, that we will be made holy, just as he declares us holy. I say this to our shame. Do we live this? Do we believe this? And if we truly believe this, then our lives should reflect exactly what our heart believes. Because it's out of our heart that we act and our mouth speaks. If the world tells us to deny Christ, or you will die, or your child will die, will you do it? Why then do, when the world says to stay inside, stop taking care of the body, or witnessing to our neighbors because we all need to do our part to preserve this life, do we? Is this something truly that we should go to the uttermost? I know I'm going against other counsel here, but this is the word of God as he has commanded us. In submitting to Christ, are we not first commanded to preserve the soul of our neighbors and our families and our loved ones and take care of the sick and the weak that is in the body? Where is our boldness when we face death? Where is our ability and our belief when we can say that, oh death, where is your victory? Oh grave, where is your sting? We talk about the missionaries down in Peru, right? Think about their condition and their situation. And their reports of ministering to the people that are shut in. And their reports of having people locked in their house. Something that they didn't ask for, but it has been laid on them. All they are doing is simply submitting to the will of God. And they are giving of their lives for the sake of others that they might win some. We should be mimicking that, and we should be supporting that to its utmost, because that is exactly what we see in the Word of God. My dad has stage 4 cancer. It metastasized originally in a lymph node in his arm. It moved to his sternum and then to his small intestines. And while he went to biweekly checkups, he also underwent 4 surgeries. 2 in the small intestine. He has his sternum removed, and his lymph nodes under his arm were removed as well. But while he's going to these checkups, he noticed the people in the waiting room, and he says you can just see it on their faces that everybody in the waiting room is grieving because they don't know what to do. Death of this life is imminent, and they have no hope. And he saw that, and it grieved him. And he sees the fear on their faces, and God called to his heart, and he realized, and he told me this, that I believe God gave me this cancer so that I could actually witness to the people in this waiting room and to the doctors. He went in with joy on his face, knowing that he had stage 4 cancer. He says, I think God gave this to me so that I can share my faith with those people who have no hope. And at least I know exactly what they're going through. And I'm at the worst end of it, stage 4. My dad, in that moment, revealed to me that he was a man who believes that God is able to raise him up on that last day. So, to let that sink in a second, we're going to now transition away from this idea of being a slave to Christ. And now we're going to hit the other end of this. In verse 25 through 31 is the next section. And it says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies, and he who loves his wife loves himself. For no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, but as Christ does the church, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Now, just as the other section was written, in a sense, to the men, we can understand it, if you will, better, because it drives exactly at who we are as men, the idea of authority, of a military hierarchy, of a headship. This drives at the heart of women. But just as this doesn't come naturally to the men, notice that it's the husbands who are to love the wives. So just as we were originally to learn from the women on how to submit, what it means to submit godly to the Lord, women, you are actually to learn what it's like to love from your husbands. And that's what this passage seems to say. But also notice that for men, it's hard for us to love other people, but we are great at loving ourselves. We're very selfish. And then anybody who is married, and I will ask your wives, is it not true that we as husbands tend, for the most part, to look to ourselves initially? It's hard for us to consider others. It is not a natural tendency for us, but it is a God-given love that we can do it. So notice this. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. And these are commands initially to the men. Also, this is also echoed in the beginning of chapter 5. Christ says it very similar. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. It says to be imitators of God. Walk in love. So if love doesn't come naturally to us, then how do we learn to love? The love here actually is not referring to a brotherly love. It's not referring to a lustful love. It's not referring to just a common, basic, everyday, I'm meeting your needs sort of love. This actually is the Greek word agapeo. Okay, obviously we understand as agape, or God's love. This is the love that is demonstrated by God himself. And so if we were to learn what this love looks like, then we have to reflect and only understand it from that perspective. But we men, as selfish creatures, we have to understand, why are we doing this? What is God saying the purpose of loving our bride is? What does this text say? So that we might be able to present her, sanctifying her, making her holy, cleansing her, that we might present our bride without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, to be holy, without blemish. It's an interesting concept, and it's one that's actually foreign in today's world, of a bride coming before her husband on the wedding day as pure, as a virgin, unblemished, holy, as pure as her white dress that she wears. And to my shame, I was not a virgin on my wedding day. The lust of my youth with different women I had dated is still a shame. It's a mark. It's not something I'm proud of. Sometimes it still constricts my feelings of unworthiness. And it actually was a big struggle in our early years of our marriage. But I will glory in my wife She presented herself to me, holy, pure, unashamed, on our wedding day. And that beautiful, beautiful picture of what that means, completely set apart only to me. This is what Christ is talking about right here when he's talking about the church. That we are to be holy, completely set apart, without blemish, loving the way that God loves. Dwell on that for a second. Think about that just for 1 second. What a beautiful, beautiful picture of being unashamed before each other in marriage, just as God designed it. So think about this, men in the society, young men, our husbands, with our children, with our daughters. How much are we willing to sacrifice to preserve the holiness of our women, our daughters, and our wives? This goes even to our sisters in the Lord. How much is this church willing to preserve the women in this body to be set apart wholly for their husbands? This is that beautiful picture of Christ in his church. The Jews celebrate actually a holiday that actually commemorates a marriage reunion, or a marriage union between them and God. And it's during the giving of the Ten Commandments, they view this as a marriage union. And it's actually the Feast of Shavuot by Jewish terms, but we understand it to be the day of Pentecost. And on this day, the Ten Commandments are read, it's commemorated, to remember when God proclaimed to them at Mount Sinai that this is out of Exodus chapter 19, beginning in verse 5. God declares, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And the people replied, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. So just as the bride would go and prepare themselves, Israel took 3 days to prepare themselves, to wash themselves, to cleanse themselves, so that they would to consecrate themselves, so that they would present themselves to God holy, clean, ready to go. So if you can think about this, it's the same thing as us in before in our weddings, right? There's the will you take, and so on and so on, and the repeat of I do. This is exactly what's going on. This is how the Jews view this, the marriage of God to his chosen people. And that's why in the Old Testament, after that, you read that he talks to them as his wife. It is that in that language. Now, just as Israel was declared to be a chosen people, a kingdom of priests, and a holy nation, Peter actually echoes this in his epistle, the first epistle. He says that we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. It's the same wording. So on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descended upon them, just as the mountain was covered in fire, God's holy fire, the holy fire of God descended on the apostles, and they received the Spirit of God in themselves. What was their image of that day? Think about what the apostles were thinking. They are celebrating the marriage, the new marriage of Christ with his new covenant, his new bride, the one that would be holy and wholly set apart to the world. That is the day, the image that we should think about on the day of Pentecost. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we go back there. Verse 15 says, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is written, the two shall become one flesh, but he who is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. this idea of God joining us as one body in Christ, as his holy, perfect, spotless bride, is everywhere. It is the heartbeat of, I would say, of all the scriptures, is God's holiness and his desire that we become holy just as he is holy. So when people tell me that, when I tell people that God demands that we should be holy and to live holy lives, there's always a bit of a scoff, because the question I'm sure some of you are thinking of, wait a minute, if we are to be holy, how can we be holy if we're sinners and we sin every day? My reply always is this: you do not fully understand the grace that you've been given to you. Because God has declared you holy. 1 Corinthians 6:11, but you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Notice the past tense, sanctified. You are holy. God has declared it of you. He has declared you justified before him. So take some time this week. Understand what it really means to live as a holy, perfect, spotless bride of Christ, because that is what God is holding us to. So the question is if we are declared holy, then how do we become holy? Because, man, I do sin every day. This doesn't make sense. Well, the answer to that actually is in our text in verse 26. And it is by the cleansing the bride, the wife, by the washing of water with the word. This idea of washing with water, is the idea of actually cleaning yourself, if you will. It actually means to bathe. The word is actually to baptize. You are baptizing yourself. You're baptizing your wife in the word. And the word here isn't the word that we use for Christ as being the word of God, as in John chapter 1. It is actually the idea of it is the spoken words of God as described in Scripture out of Timothy there, that all Scripture is God-breathed. It is these words. So we are to actually take and wash ourselves, to baptize ourselves in the word of God itself. And that is how we present ourselves clean and holy before God, is by knowing his word day in, day out, baptizing, immersing ourselves, just as we would shower daily. So the honest question is here is how do we honestly feel about the word of God? Do we honestly take it as the inerrant truth? Do we honestly understand God's word to be without error, to be truly divinely inspired by him? That we can hold on to this in spite of whatever the world tells us. Do we believe that the world was created in 6 literal days, 24-hour days, because there was evening and there was morning each day? Can we believe that? Do we believe that? Do we believe that the flood of Noah actually happened throughout the entire world and not just right where Noah was at on that moment in a valley? Do we believe that Christ is able to actually calm a sea, raise the dead, heal the lame, make the blind see, and even raise the dead and raise us from the dead? How we approach his word is something that is also to be sanctified. I say this in jest, but are we a church that truly baptizes in the word, or are we a church that sprinkles? Also notice here that God is not calling just a few of us to do this task. He is calling all people in the church. He is calling his church specifically, every single individual in the body, to baptize yourselves with the word, to baptize your wives in the word. This is not just the pastor's job. This is not just the elder's job. Although they have a small part, they do not have the majority part. If you are not feeding yourselves, you do not understand his word, and you do not understand his grace. And I will hold to that. We also understand from Awana, of course, that out of 2 Timothy, it says, do your best to present yourself a to God as one approved, a worker who is not ashamed, or no need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Verses 28 through 30 go on to tell us that in the same way husbands should love their wives as their own bodies, and he who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This idea, like I said, is agape. Do we love our wives? We agape the body of Christ. And bodies here is not just talking about the figurative idea of a body. It's not talking about that at all, actually. It goes on to clarify in verse 29, no one has ever hated his own flesh. We are the literal flesh and bones of Christ. That's what this is talking about. Just as a husband joins to his wife and they cleave to each other, we who are in Christ have cleaved to him, and he now sees us as his body, his flesh, his bones. That's why Paul says this is a profound mystery. It's not figurative, people. Do we understand that you are the flesh of Christ, and you are the flesh of Christ, and you are the flesh of Christ? Do we hold to each other as that same flesh? When you weep, do I weep with you? When you mourn, do I mourn with you? When you rejoice, do I rejoice with you? As one body, we feel and sense each other as one whole entity. This is not figurative. It's not figurative because he quotes it as not being figurative, just as he quotes out of Genesis there. But it's interesting because he says here that in verse 29, no one has ever hated his own flesh. That word hated there means to persecute, to flog, to destroy. No one will willingly cut off his leg or mar themselves. Why? Because we love ourselves. We don't want to experience that pain. But let us check ourselves. Are we doing that with our wives? Men, women, are we doing that with our husbands? But because this, he's talking about this is part of the church, are we doing that with the church? Are we purposely cutting off our own feet, our own legs? For what reason? Does not the rest of the flesh moan and scream in pain? Verse 30, we are all members of one body. That's what he's getting at here. We have all been joined together. How then should we love with God's love? What a mystery that God has given to us to tell us. Out of 1 Corinthians 6 again, which seems to be very parallel as I studied this, verse 16, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? This is something that is not just hit on here, but understand that it is still the flesh. So think on this, as Christ's flesh, and if we are Christ's flesh in this world right now, then we are the physical embodiment of Christ to all those around us. I think that should cause us to sober up, shouldn't it? That the way our neighbors look at us, that the way the world sees us, even through these times, is how they see Christ and how they will judge our God and our Savior. It is through us. This should cause us concern. So we're going to get real practical here for a moment. If we're all fighting the same thing in the world, we're all bickering in the same way, when do we meet? How do we meet? Inside, outside, upside down, wearing the right clothes. Is this really displaying the love of Christ that is being showed to us here in these passages? do we really, what I see here is that we really care less about the teaching of his word in our day-to-day lives, and rather that we care more about whether people are all feeling that their needs are being met, passionately able to watch it in their house, under air conditioning, outside or whatever, even inside. How much more passionate should we actually be about the words of Christ? Think about this. God has forced us outdoors. When was the last time our neighbors heard the word of God? And yet it's being proclaimed through these speakers. Praise God. Praise God. It's funny that God sometimes persecutes his church because we're not doing what he's asked us to do. And we've seen that in scriptures as well. So to rationalize this, you know, where is our focus? Where should our focus be? Are we truly loving each other as is commanded for us? Are we going to those in our body who aren't coming and meeting some of their needs? Do we know their needs? Are we going to them because they refuse to come to us? Our flesh and bones. Are we loving them the way Christ loves them and giving them that special love that they need during this time? The encouragement. The communion. When was the last time you shared communion with anybody in this body? Especially those who are shut in. Especially those who cannot make it. We see that the washing of the word is left up to us, just as he has commanded the church to do it. John chapter 13. Beginning in verse 34 and 35. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. What is God saying here about the best way to reach our world? It is by our love for each other. Are we displaying that during this time? Is the bickering of a building, is that really the church? No, it's the flesh and bones that we see around us. I stand before you today because I am burdened and I am hurt by the state of the church in the world. And unfortunately, it's on our front door. I think we can do better at loving each other. Christ ends Ephesians 5 with this: however, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. If this is talking about the church, then it's reread this way: let each one of you love the church just as Christ himself, and let the church see that she respects Christ. Like I said, this is an inclusio. The fear, that awe, the respect that we say that we are in Christ and we are under his grace and we are saved by him. Let this drive us to be bold, to be fearless, to look death in the eye and continue to march forward. Let us also do it in love, as Christ has loved us, with godly love, with the impassion that he has of sacrificing himself for us and washing us in the word, that we should be washing each other and spurring each other on. Man, let us hold on to that belief that we will one day be raised from the dead, and that we truly do worship the God of the living. And let us love each other, that this would reflect on our neighbors and our world, and they would desire to come to know the God that we have because of our love for each other. I understand that this has been a little harsh today, and it took me a while to argue with God of, are you sure, Lord, that this is where you want me to talk through? It is not a position that I want to be in, and I have grown so much through studying this, and I have had to repent multiple times as I went through this. And so I am encouraging you as a fellow brother that we all need to step up our game. We all need to be honoring Christ, and then we all need to be fearless, just as we expect all those around the world to do. There's no different here. We should be no different here. Father, I come before you right now with a heavy heart, your word just in conviction to my soul, Lord, and I pray that it has reached out to convict my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, and you, Lord, I pray that the church would become strong, that the church would become a cornerstone, a rock, a pillar, as you are, so we should be. Father, I pray you make us holy. Teach us to be holy, to know what a holy life looks like, just as you declared it of us. Father, we just come before you, repentant now, heavy-hearted. Lord, we pray that we have not made a mockery of you, and if we have, Lord, let us repent. Let us declare your glories and your riches. Let our witness, our flesh shine just as you are, Lord, that we are your body, your physical manifestation to this world, that we are a royal priesthood guiding the world into relationship with you. This is all about a relationship with you, Lord. Let us make that important. Let us take the time to wash ourselves in your word, to daily bathe ourselves in your word, and not just get sprinkled on the weekends, Lord. Father, grow us, mature us, nourish us, as you have done, as Christ has done for his church. Grow us to maturity. Make us all one in unity, one in flesh, holding and lifting each other up and spurring each other on to good works and good deeds. So, Father, as we come before you in worship, let us truly reflect on the God we serve. Let us truly reflect on you, Christ, our head and authority. And we are just nothing but humble slaves. And yet you love us as a wife. You love us as your beloved, as your betrothed. What a profound, profound mystery that you have revealed to us, and how glorious and beautiful it is. We just thank you for this. We thank you that we can understand this when we say that we are in Christ and everything is in the name of Christ. Just as we pray today, Lord, in all glory and love and honor, goes to you forever and ever, and may our lives show that. In Christ, we pray these things. Oh God, amen.
Thanks, Rob. So what's our response to being made holy? Not through any works of our own, but only through He who can make us holy. What's our response? Let's stand and sing.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. His own blood for my soul. I see no helpless of his glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole. His nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well,
it is well with my soul.
With my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. Never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. The moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will see
of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, all my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now.
I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The word is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living. Kingdoms rise and fall. There is still one King reigning over all. So I will not fear.
glory. I will trust in His name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. The dread of night overwhelms my soul. He is here with me. I am not alone, for His love is sure. And He knows my name, for my God is the Ancient of Days. I may not see what the future brings. I will watch and wait for the Savior King. In my joy complete, standing face to face in the presence of the Ancient of Days.
None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hands. For His throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in His name.
For my God is the Ancient of Days. For my God is the Ancient of Days.
Now I myself am confident concerning you, my brethren, that you are all full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and able to admonish one another. As we depart this week, may we continue to walk in the truth of His word.